into positions of hopelessness and helplessness. The government gives them the drugs, builds bigger prisons, passes a three-strike law, and then wants us to sing God Bless America. No, no, no.
You can't understand
how I can just run a podcast.
Yeah. Hi, I'm back from LA. Wow, that was dumb. That was a dumb place to go be for a while. I'll be back soon, I think.
Suck it, LA.
Wow, we're Jesus Christ. You. Yeah, fuck, man. The entertainment industry is horrible. Everyone's getting fucked over. The whole city is just covered in gasoline, and everyone's fighting over the match. I'd never want to go back. I'll be back in 2 weeks. Anyway.
No matter how bad it is, just know that TJ Miller will always have an easier time getting on shows than you.
Apparently, he's back.
What?
Yeah, they booked him on Hot Tub on Monday. And then it's unclear what the details were, but this woman was very upset. She was at the Virgil Bar where Hot Tub takes place. And she was dragged out rather violently by bouncers and the bar manager. I'm kind of unclear whether it related to her protesting TJ Miller being on the show. People are saying it's incidental, but that's even worse.
Right.
It's like, oh, they beat the shit out of this brown woman and they booked TJ Miller.
We were just beating up a woman. We didn't know he was there.
Yeah.
Hey, maybe they should have cast TJ Miller's career as Deadpool because it cannot die.
Go
folks.
Off.
Ready Player None.
Yeah. Was he in that?
Yeah, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was a CGI character though, so you couldn't see his dumb face.
Yeah, he's the one that yelled Denver.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
That's what he yells.
Hello. I'm Jake Flores. I got with me Raghav Mehta.
Hey.
Alex Patak.
I was in Ready Player One.
No, you weren't. And special guest this week, Max Ogle, comedian.
Hi. Hey, how's it going, y'all?
Good. Welcome to the show. Everything's horrible. I just got back in town. A news article about my neighborhood reads a 15-year-old man was killed by the cops in this neighborhood. 15-year-old man, an old baby was killed.
It's your lived experience that counts.
What did I miss since I've been gone? What do you got? What's been going on with you all?
Well, not a lot. There was a funny story yesterday in Splinter by Libby Watson, the great Libby Watson. Apparently, this Gothamist reporter, Jen Chung, just posted this like snarky tweet, and it was like a picture of a dog on the one train in Uptown, and it was just like, hey, fuzzy dog on the train. And the MTA like very immediately were like, if you see a dog on board, please alert 911 or the nearest crew member, which is insane because dogs are allowed. I mean, I think the law is they have to be in a bag,
mm-hmm.
Which is just for aesthetic purposes because it's adorable, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Well, if they're out of the bag, their paws are free to graffiti.
Oh, yeah. They can be all Antifa about it. And you know the Antifa dogs are coming for us.
I'm imagining the police arresting a dog, and it's fun.
I'm imagining dog ice. they're keeping the puppies in cages, separating them from the older dogs.
But anyway, yeah, they tweeted this, and the Gothamist writer, Jen, was just like, yeah, I just wanted to share this cute dog picture. I'm not sure what's happening right now. And then the NTA apologized. One of our colleagues was mistaken in his response. Please do not call 911 unless there's an emergency or unless we tell you to. They capped it with this. We love cute doggos as much as you, but they need to be at carriers while riding on a train. The article is tongue-in-cheek, headline, the New York subway has become a totalitarian anti-dog police state, which is not out of the realm of possibility, but, like, I don't know, we are in New York, I get stopped leaving Union Square all the time I saw a little band called Radiohead over the weekend. That's what I was doing, so I'm very on brand.
Oh, very cool.
Yes, very cool. That's the biggest cool band in the world.
I'm such a nerd. I love Star Wars and Radiohead.
Yeah. I love Harry Potter and reading Radiohead lyrics.
You know what I can't stop imagining is a news story that's like, a 15-year-old adult dog was found on the train in a subway. 15 years old in dog years makes him an adult man dog.
But it was terrifying because I went in with some drugs. They're fine. And they were just fucking cops everywhere. And they're cops with dogs, cute doggos, not in bags, just roaming around, sniffing for drugs. And I'm like approaching the security
gate. At Radiohead.
What?
At Radiohead.
Yes, it's insane.
Those are karma police. So you can drugs.
Exactly. Which they closed with that. And I think that was very intentional. But anyway, and I just freaked out. I had to throw like all these mushrooms away. And that, like,
there's like a guy in the corner just like unloading a bunch of Chuck Klosterman books from his tote bag. Like, God, the cops are onto me.
And I had like taken a bunch of mushrooms before reaching the venue, so I'm losing my mind. And there are cops everywhere. And then I had like another bag of, and I threw it in some dirt outside. And then I left the concert, and it was still there. So all in all, a success.
Cool.
But hey, NYPD, if you're listening to this, it's all a joke. I didn't do any of this. All
right.
JK, LOL.
Always a success.
This is an irony podcast.
Satire. I'm glad that you made a treasure map back to your drugs and you were able to find them on
really
mushrooms.
We're glossing over the finding the drugs in the dirt portion of the story.
Walking out of Radiohead with a shovel and a map and a pirate hat on. Like, I'm going on an adventure. Very cool. All right, well, I'm glad that you got to live every 45-year-old man's dream and go see
that's
Radiohead.
That's my essence. I'm drinking wine right now.
You're very mature.
Oh, man, we're old as fuck.
You're an adult flavor.
Whew, damn. Well, you know, I guess you might as well blow your load on Radiohead, seeing as
oh, yeah, yeah.
We might as well.
We might as well.
Yeah, well, it just made sense to go to this concert because it is official. Pod Damn America was not allowed into Ozzy Fest.
Banned from Ozzy Fest.
The preeminent neoliberal
you cowards
festival. I don't. They didn't really say.
Karl Rove, you coward.
We'll never see Karl Rove songs now.
I want to be clear. It was just when I originally emailed them, I was like, "There's no way this is going to happen," and I said, "Pod Damn America," and they immediately responded and go, "Oh, thanks so much for reaching out. We'll get back to you." I'm like, "Can you read?" And then I get the email yesterday. It's like, "Oh, we're full." Which I can only assume they looked at our most listened to episode and listened to the first 45 seconds, which we spent shitting on Ozzy Fest, which we would have loved to attend. But what are you going to do?
They're probably just like everyone else and thought we were Pod Save America.
Yeah, I was about to say, it's pretty similar.
I've started doing shows and I ask people to introduce me with that. And then I stop because someone introduced me as Pod Save America guy. Or like I'm part of that show. I'm like, no, this is very wrong. And
what
then
if
when
someone's too excited?
And then when they say Pod Damn America, I can feel people groaning at me.
Yeah.
I don't think we're popular enough to be getting groans. You think we're getting groans?
It's the name.
It's just kind of a groaner, long play on words. I didn't know this show was going to...
No, it's the name itself. No,
I just never
groan
at those things.
I didn't know this show was going to take off. so I just named it willy-nilly, something I thought was kind of funny in the moment, and now it's... And a mouthful to say every time I have to promote it.
Well, we're probably the only podcast that's ever happened to, so it's fine.
It's better than the original name, which was just the story of Jake's missing bike.
It was stolen by John Lovett. By the way, anyone listening, man, go look up this clip of this chick. I got to pause real quick and remember her name. There's a great clip of John Lovett's show, Love It or Leave It, where he has an activist on named Malina Abdullah who fucking just annihilates and embarrasses him for like 13 minutes as he keeps trying to insist to her that, like, everyone can agree that the Democratic Party returning to power is the most important thing, and that, like, Russia is the most important thing. And it's just fucking great because she's a woman of color and just says things to him very plainly, like, you know, this Russia gate name, it's like Stoshk or something. She's just like, that's not a household name in my house.
Like, everyone knows this guy.
Yeah, like, no one cares.
Everyone at my country club knows this guy.
Yeah, Russia gate is white people's shit, and, like, sort of explains, like, hey, you know, liberals are also racist, and, you know, you can't assume this sworn allegiance. It's kind of, you know, racist on some level that people just assume, like, you know, people of color and all these marginalized groups love Democrats just like us or whatever.
Bend the knee to the progressive crown.
Yeah. And the best part is that she tells him, like, you know, Democrats take money from the devil. You know, wouldn't you agree? And he just, like, gets backed into this wall so hard where he goes, like, this is almost verbatim the way he, like, dances around it. He goes, well, Democrats... Democrats have to hold out a bag and catch money that's coming off of an evil machine. So they catch the money in the bag and, like, you know, and then it just sort of, like, devolves from there and he stumbles off. Anyway, it's fucking great. Look up that clip.
Yeah, that's like when you get an album rapper in at the battle and then they choke up because, you know what, they're not used to the improv game of the rap battle.
Yes. Scribble Jam, man. Early Eminem, Slug from Atmosphere, all embarrassing themselves.
Ali, all the Rhyme Slayers.
Yeah.
Hey, shout out to all the Rhyme Slayers real quick.
R.I.P. Idea.
Oh, is he dead?
Yeah, he died like 8 years ago.
A year ago or eight
years ago?
8 years ago?
Yeah, yeah. I was the last person who interviewed him.
Wow, I didn't
know. Yeah, it was fucking crazy. I used to love the guy. I would see him around town all the time, and he was really nice and great. Digression, look up Idea of Idea and Abilities, legendary hip-hop, underground hip-hop duo from Minneapolis.
He'll be the outro this this week. Damn, I haven't listened to Idea in 8 years, and I just realized that's why.
Yeah,
suddenly
still good.
He stopped being
around.
Why
don't they come by anymore?
Anyways,
is John Candy these days?
Yeah. Robin Williams hasn't come into the old soda shop for a while. Who else is dead? Everyone?
Yeah.
He's just up there with Little Peep. They're just having a grand old time.
Oh, my God. When I was in L.A., like, this is so weird. I don't know, like... You just get this weird David Lynch-y feeling when you're there. Like, something seems afoot and everything is, like, shiny and bright or whatever. I ran into a pal of mine that I hadn't seen since I lived in Austin. It was just, like, a East Side person, not even a comic or anything. Just randomly run into each other. And I go, like, what's going on? How are you? She's like, terrible. I've been unemployed ever since my boss, Little Peep, died.
God. Oh, my God. Yeah.
Which is, like, hilarious on a level of, like, wait, he had employees? Right. SoundCloud rappers have employees?
Dude, he had an empire. He was about to blow.
Yeah.
R.I.P. Little Peep.
Yeah,
talk
rest
about
in peace.
Very sad, honestly.
He'll talk be about the, a dead young man.
He'll be the intro. Or I'll put them both on.
God bless.
Mix them together. Play them at the same time.
Yeah, I'll do a mashup. Idea, little idea.
The episode is a week late because Jake is constructing a Lil Peep mashup.
Oh no! I mashed up my Little Peep. I don't know.
That's what I call when I beat my dick. Okay.
That's what I was going for.
It might. It's going to get cut. It's fine.
Cut it. All right. Yo, podcast DJ, cut that shit. Anyway, on to our tale of the week here. Not our story. Rather, our trip through history.
Open the book.
Max Ogle, you are here to tell us about West Virginia. And the reason I think... there's no segue into this. Like, there's nothing that really happened in West Virginia, I guess, this week that we could really use to segue into this. I just remember talking to you in a bar about a lot of things.
Yeah.
And your knowledge of West Virginia was very interesting to me, historically, with leftist shit, unions and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Labor struggles.
Yeah.
Get out your rocking chairs and or ATVs, because we're going to West Virginia.
I mean, I suppose this is relevant because, like, Amazon workers are on strike right now. And
yeah,
and
I mean,
strikes.
You know, not too long ago you had, like, the Wildcat teacher strike in West Virginia, which, I don't know, there were, like, one or two more teacher strikes in other states after that. So, I don't know, we have, like, a long history of, like, starting shit off you know, in like ways.
You have a long history of starting shit.
Yeah, we start some shit, dude.
Yeah, Bernie Sanders won the West Virginia primary.
It did.
Oh,
did.
Don't make me start some shit.
Socialism will never work out there.
No, of course
they don't want it at all.
I was back home a week ago, and I was like, Mom, why wouldn't, like, you believe in socialist stuff, like, why wouldn't you vote for a socialist? And she's like, he could never win here. I'm like, Bernie Sanders literally won there.
Yeah.
It was wild.
Old people.
Hard, too.
Older people are, they follow this very, like, sad phenomenon where they don't vote for the people they like because they convince themselves that they wouldn't vote for it. It's so confusing.
Yeah. Well, like, if you, but if he won the, like, the primary and then he was, right, him versus the Republican.
He, like, the Democrats in the state would have voted for Bernie Sanders. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
I like the term wildcat strike because it always reminds me of that joke on The Simpsons when there's like a kid's football team. They're like, who are we? The Wildcats. Who are we going to beat? The Wildcats. Because every elementary school has like their middle school has like the same mascot for some reason.
Yeah.
It's always like the Bobcats or some shit.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's like a specific part of the country that get really.
I think that
joke
might just be like maybe middle schools like built after it wasn't okay to name them after Native Americans anymore.
Middle school,
we're just doing cats now. Yeah. Pick a cat.
Yeah. I think that's like the safe thing they landed on. Because like, yeah, the Native American thing is racist. My elementary school was pirates, and I just remember hearing like concerned mothers all the time just like standing in the fucking front office of the place just yelling at the principal like, they're rapists, they're murderers, you know? Why is my child being called a rapist, you know?
Well, the runner-up name
plagiarized that woman.
Yeah. Well, the runner-up name was Rottweilers, and we don't want to demonize bully breeds.
No.
You know? So
yeah,
they're good dogs,
but I don't know. So West Virginia,
the school's called the Pit Bulls, and everyone's like, put them down. They're not safe.
Dolly.
It's so where I'm from is basically been experiencing like a semi-industrial mono economy for like the past, I don't know, probably 150 years,
mm-hmm.
You know? So, you know, like we've had like a little bit of steel, but it's always mostly just been coal in places like southern West Virginia, eastern Kentucky, and like southwestern Virginia. Like that part of Appalachia has just all been coal fields forever. So, you know, you have like the formation of West Virginia after the beginning of the Civil War. Up until then, it was basically they were taking migrants from like port cities. And they would do this thing where they would name, like, a coal camp, like, we're going to New Paris or, you know, like, Boston. Or they would just name them big cities. And so people would get on, like, a train or a caravan.
Sounds
and they'll be like, and
nice.
We got work for you there. So they're like, fuck, yeah, dude.
We're going to Ogdenville.
Yeah, first day in America. I'm already employed in the big city. And then they'd
You're telling me I'll have a job at Fucktown?
Yeah. Yeah, and so, you know, and they'd get there, and it'd be in, like, the middle of the Appalachian Mountains with, like, you know, barely any, like, houses, mostly tents. And they'd be like, and we got a job for you mining coal. And they'd be like, and we're not going back. So you can either work and have a place to stay or, I guess, go live in the woods with no resources. So they're basically like Shanghaiing workers there in the beginning.
Yeah.
And then traditionally from like the 1850s, 60s until around, I think like the early 1900s, miners were housed in homes owned by the companies and only paid in what was called company scrip, which is basically like monopoly money that was good at like the companies like Walmart or whatever.
Footworkers bucks.
Wow. Yeah.
If only there's some sort of social media mogul that does something similar today.
Right. You should just start taking notes because this is just where we're going again soon.
Yeah, yeah, no,
you're
exactly.
We're all going to live at Google
House. People are living
house.
In Facebook camps.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fucking crazy.
Look, no. You can either go out in the woods or you can sit down in the social media mines.
Yeah.
Yeah. I already bought a ticket to something called New Brooklyn. It's in upstate New York.
Go lay in the news feed.
They've got a job for you tweeting there.
They ain't ready.
I mean, yeah, they weren't called coal barons for nothing. It was just like American feudalism, you know, and the whole economy centered around this one thing. You know, like the only person that really made any real money was like a town doctor because like the company had to pay them real money, but that's about it. And so obviously, you know, around like the beginning, like the early 1900s, like people started to like organize and unionize and strike, which like hurt the bottom line of coal companies like a lot.
And, oh, no.
I mean, yeah. But I mean, like, especially at the turn of the century, coal was like the energy source. It was like the only thing that was really powering, you know, industrialization in the U.S. Like New York City was transforming. It was the only thing they used to make steel. So like while the country was like being transformed in like a post-industrial, you know, America we know today, like this was probably like the most important. It was like the, I don't want to say like the Middle East of America, but it's like that fuel source was like as we, they were as dependent on that as we are on the Middle East oil today, kind of thing.
So as oil is Texas tea, coal would be
West Virginia
crumpets.
I was actually about to say crumpets.
West Virginia crumpets.
Groupthink, dude.
Get out of my mind.
Dude, it's...
I was going to say pierogies.
And into my car.
And into my car. Get my fucking car.
My fossil-fueled car.
So as, like, unions picked up and they were, you know, gaining more power, companies just started evicting union members and union sympathizers because they owned the houses.
And weren't unions, like, illegal at this time, too?
Yeah, they weren't illegal, but they weren't, like, protected at all.
Union activity was illegal.
Yeah.
Just before, like, they even became, like, a legally recognized.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, what year is this now?
This is about, like, 15-ish is okay. Like when the evictions start happening.
So post-industrial evolution and rampant labor abuses.
Exactly.
That
yeah.
Haven't been accounted for.
Shit's all Peaky Blinders-y.
Yeah. Yeah. And so,
right.
You know, like you'll have like little like bits of unrest scattered around because, you know, like a group of miners would see a woman and her children being thrown into the street with all their belongings. Well, like her husband was at work, you know,
see,
so he couldn't
some
do anything.
In the street.
They're all British for some reason.
And
do you like dogs?
They
I'll
didn't.
Stop this now.
They didn't have like an incorporated police force either in these towns. They would only hire like either Pinkertons or in the case of, you know, camps outside of Mate One, West Virginia, the Baldwin Felts Agency. Which was called in on May 19, 1920 to put down labor disputes in, like, camps outside of Mate One. And so the Baldwin Felts guys were real fucking motherfuckers. They were called the Baldwin Thugs.
So they're a detective agency?
Yeah, but, like, so, what? Like, they're a detective agency, but they're just dudes with guns that will come.
So they're, like... the early 1900s team of private investigators or whatever. Or, like, what are they?
They're, like,
they sound like mercenaries.
They're basically mercenaries.
They would detect that they're about to kick your ass.
Yeah. I don't know. The fun thing about the Baldwin Felts Agency is that they were...
Alex is impressed.
they were bought by the Pinkertons, who we all know and love. And then the Pinkertons were bought by Securitas, which is, like, still... a thing today.
Project Securitas.
Yeah, you know, and you know, it's fun because sometimes you see them running around refilling ATMs, and you're like, "You shot my great-grandfather."
Damn. Wait, so like, what do they do today? They're not just, allowed to just go hit people with a truncheon anymore.
Well, they're like private security forces, or you know, they're still standing around rich people with guns.
Oh, okay.
You know? That's basically what they do now.
It's good work if you can get it.
Hired
you
know? Muscle.
Mm-hmm. So
it'd be cool to have a job from like 100 years ago.
Yeah,
I'm a goon.
Yeah,
I specialize in goonery. I have a LinkedIn account.
Well, I feel like we specifically just know a lot of people who would be hired goons.
I would goon so hard.
They don't really fit into a lot of clerical work. It's just like, look, hit that guy. Come back every Wednesday. It's your job.
Yeah. I'd be the fast talking short one that comes out from behind the tall one.
Oh yeah,
you know,
Max is scrappy.
Mm-hmm.
A little bowler hat and a cigar.
Oh, yeah. I'd hit you in the stomach real hard with brass knuckles.
Yeah, you're looking up. You're looking up at the big one. Then what's down there? It's Max in the little hat.
He throws his hat at you like Odd Job. It's got a razor in it.
Fuck, dude. No, I'm out. That's too much. So they, like, enter this town to, like, because there's a big strike, right? Everyone in those coal fields, they all organize. They all get evicted from their houses. They're living in tent cities, like outside the coal camp and outside of the town of Mate One. So the company calls in the Baldwin Felts Agency to like come bust it up and get everyone back to work. So first things first, they try to bribe the mayor of the town, Mayor Testman, $500 in 1910 to just go on the roofs of the buildings in the city and just set up machine gun emplacements. And he's like, no, you can't do that.
And this is right around the time machine guns are suddenly available.
That's like
mobster
the height of technology. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like right after World War One.
So yeah.
They're good machine guns.
Yeah.
And so they're going through, they're finishing up the evictions, and then, you know, they're causing they're raising a bunch of hell. People are getting pissed. So as they're walking back to the train station to like go back and report back and get more people, they're confronted by the chief of police in Matewan named Sid Hatfield, of
hell
Hatfield
yeah.
McCoy's, you know, family
yeah.
lineage.
Yeah.
And he's
James Hatfield from Metallica, right?
Yeah.
Wait, mm-hmm. really?
That's Hatfield.
It's different.
Damn.
It would be. He walks up. He's just like, for whom the bell tolls. You know. It's yeah. very cool.
1920s guy. That's like.
Yeah.
Give
he's
me
like,
fuel. Give me fire.
Here, have a seat.
Give me the coal that I desire.
Have a seat. There's whiskey in the jarro.
Oh,
that's a cover. It's not their song originally.
Thin Lizzy.
So he's deputized like 12 or 15 miners, and so there's like kind of like an equal sides group of people between the Baldwin Feltz agents and the miners. And then, like, out of nowhere, Albert Feltz pulls out a warrant for Sid Hatfield's arrest. And then they try to, like, arrest Sid Hatfield. He runs into the mayor's jewelry store. And then, seriously, this is all true.
At the time, every mayor had a jewelry
store. He had a jewelry store, you know?
To the jewelry store.
He's trying to help his people shine out there, you know? And so the mayor comes out, and he's like, whoa, guys, what's going on? And they're like, we have a warrant for his arrest. They show the warrant to the mayor. The mayor's like, this is a bogus warrant. They're literally just yelling things at each other. And then after the mayor yells, this is a bogus warrant, the Baldwin Feltz agency just opens fire on the miners. And so the miners, there's a huge gunfight, and I think it's like 7 Baldwin Feltz agents, including Albert Feltz, die. And 3 people on the miner side die, including Mayor Testament, who's like literally shot dead on the steps of City Hall.
Now who will run the jewelry store?
Well, fun story. Sid Hatfield turned
the
that jewelry store. He turned that jewelry store into a gun store.
Hell,
He was like, all right, guys, I'm just going to start selling you guns.
These are expensive guns. They're jewel-encrusted.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
And
I have to say, every time you say Albert Feltz, I keep thinking you're going to say Albert Fish, who is the Brooklyn pedophile cannibal from the 1920s.
Mm-hmm.
Very different story, but I need to get it out of my head.
Listen, okay. All Alberts are the same. You heard it here first.
Fat Albert, Albert Feltz.
Fat Albert, any Albert.
Fat
you
Albert
know.
Fish would be a good Halloween costume.
It's just the more successful Albert Fish.
Hey, 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 I'll watch you kids.
Honestly, kind of goes with the spirit of the creator.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, it's not like that far off. I mean, it is pretty far up. But
you watch a lot of serial killer stuff.
Oh, too much.
Sometimes I see you and you have dark rings under your eyes, and I'm like, you've been up all night listening to podcasts about Albert Fish, haven't you?
Well, like reading about like child trafficking or whatever. Like, it's real. And then everyone's like, yeah, we know.
Go to sleep. Jesus.
Get some rest, Rog.
So that was the Matewan Massacre. That's what that was called.
What's it called?
The Matewan Massacre.
Matewan?
Matewan.
Matewan.
Yeah, there's lots of fun names. Just strap in, bud.
Matewan, is that my cousin? that's
you laugh, but I have a cousin, Matewan.
Do you really?
No, you
do
don't.
You?
Do so.
Whoa. Holy shit. You should do that. Singer? You should go play like black comedy rooms and do that joke.
Me and my cousin, Matewan.
the whitest person on earth.
Yeah. So, you know, like, after that, it's kind of on, you know, like, more people start striking. All the miners are living in, like, tent cities, which would, like, regularly be, like, harassed by, like, Baldwin agents. Like, they'd come in and either just, like, knock down tents and rip shit to shreds, or they'd sometimes, like, take boxcars, and then they'd put a machine gun in one of them, and then as the train went by, they would just rake the tent cities with machine gun fire.
One of those things is worse than the other.
One of them is.
They either knock over your tent or shoot a train full of people with a machine gun.
One time, there was a tent city outside of Lick Creek that got raided by Captain Brockus of, I want to say, oh, shit, like, I think it was Mingo County. He went there with the state police, and so, like, the miners saw him coming, and they, like, kind of dug in and, like, just were, like, holding guns out, like, hey, you can't come here, like, on some, like, show me a warrant shit, you know? And then they just continue to, like, push past those guys, break everyone's tents, pile up all their belongings, and then light them on fire.
Oh. That was the first libertarian.
Yeah.
Am I being detained, sir? As he's getting blown away with a fucking machine gun.
And so miners would just, like, do, like, little acts of guerrilla warfare, like, ambushing, like, state police or, like, Baldwin Felt's agents in the woods or blowing up coal shafts or coal tipples, which actually Sid Hatfield got arrested for blowing up a coal tipple later on.
Guys, we joke around on here, but it's not cool to talk about hurting a Baldwin agent.
Hey, Baldwin agents have families,
they have
and it's
families,
a tough job.
They're working for America.
Mm-hmm. Are you worried we're going to get our door kicked in by the Pinkerton agency?
We're the historical Department of Homeland Security. We're representing the Rockefellers.
Three guys only wearing a monocle.
Yeah. They're sharing a monocle.
Yeah, they're sharing the same monocle.
One really big monocle.
One of them is Mr. Peanut.
So on January 21st, 1921, Sid Hatfield has to go stand trial for the murder of Albert Feltz. He was like kind of like a local like folk hero like throughout the region. So like he's down there. He's like fucking shaking hands with reporters, like kissing babies. Like he's like a star, you know. Even though like he ended up getting acquitted for that because they were like, well, you know, it was a self-defense-y kind of thing. Like union efforts were actually like taking like big hits. Like 80% of coal mines were back operational by that time because either they were importing scabs, fucking piece of shit, or they were getting striking miners back and making them sign like yellow dog contracts, which were basically sort of like a modern day like non-compete clause or like non-disclosure agreement. Like they couldn't say anything about their salary. They couldn't say anything bad about the mines. If they were like around anyone known to be a union sympathizer, like they lost their job.
Right.
It must have been so easy to find scabs back then because they just came up to like a little boy and it's like, hey, would you like to make 30 cents? And it's like, of course.
Want to stop living in a tent?
Yeah. Hey, and now he has black lung. Yeah.
I see you got a lollipop there, boy. How'd you like to make enough money after a hard day's work to have two lollipops
to keep it. Yeah.
It was hard to sign these contracts though because if you signed a yellow dog contract, they wouldn't let you on the New York City subway without a bag.
These contracts were actually outlawed in 1932 under the Norris LaGuardia Act.
Woo!
Right
down the act.
Shouts to the airport, dude.
Getting a tattoo of this act.
You know, there's, like, a lot of other big guerrilla skirmishes. You have, like, the 3 days battle along the Tug River Valley, I think it was Harding threatened to call in the National Guard, so the miners stopped, and then martial law was imposed in the area, which was really only used to harass Union people and, you know, just, like, arrest them for jaywalking and then put them in, like, large prison camps. You know, like the tensions start rising again. And then, on August 1st, 1921, Sid Hatfield is on trial again for blowing up a coal tipple with dynamite, which is rad as fuck. He's just like,
he's Wile E. Coyote.
Yeah, exactly. Like I just imagine him sticking like a giant red stick in something and it blowing. It's so cool. I fucking love where I'm from.
Proud.
Yeah. Right.
So true.
He travels to the McDowell County Courthouse with his friend Ed Chambers and their wives. And as they're walking up the steps to the courthouse, the doors of the courthouse swing open from the inside and like eight Feltz agents come out and just like unload into Sid Hatfield and Ed Chambers. And like they literally like after they like emptied their first clips, one of them ran down the stairs and like shot Ed Chambers in the back of the head again.
Right.
Damn.
And, like literally
he's
none of them,
Tupac
they never even got arrested. They just like packed, they just like dusted themselves off and walked away.
All right, you're free because that was too cool.
Yeah, that was very badass.
It's like a Godfather movie in the future.
Yeah. I object on what grounds? On the grounds that was fucking rad as hell. so like that story spread throughout, the region and then like dudes just like haulers just start like emptying out, and like people just start like buying guns or grabbing what guns they had and just like really just kind of starting to meet up. You
like
know, like
meetup.com.
Yeah, exactly. You know, miners only. But
miners meet.
So there's one group of miners that militarized along the Little Coal River, and so the sheriff of Logan County sent a bunch of state troopers to like go break them up, and then the miners ambushed them, disarmed them, and then like sent them back home walking in a straight line. Like they fucked these dudes up, and that was pretty fun.
That's single real kung file. Fu shit.
Yeah. And so, August 7th, 1921, the leaders of the UMWA in the area met with Governor Ephraim Morgan to like just present like a petition and be like peacefully like, hey, this is what we want. They just wanted their rights, and it took him like something like an hour to be like, no, I don't think so. So that brings us to what is called the Battle of Blair Mountain.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, it's a
sick-ass
name.
This is where the Blair Witch comes from.
Project happened.
Yeah. Yeah. We lost 8 good teenagers that day.
Some fucking turn-of-the-century guy standing in the corner of a room, you know, just like...
the reason they couldn't get away from that witch is because they had to set up the camera and crank it. And they'd be like, ah, the witch is here. Yeah, you know?
It's an entire movie shot on one of those cameras that you have to put a sheet over your head to use.
Looks like the witch is coming right at us.
Oh, you look real scared. So after, you know, they don't get their rights from the governor, you know, like they feel totally helpless. They're like, well, there's a bunch of miners in prison in Mingo County. Like, you know, we should just, you know, there's like 13,000 of us. Let's just march to Mingo County and free these guys, and our numbers will probably be like doubled.
Mingo County.
Yeah. Great, great names, man. And
drummer
so
for the Meatles.
So they're trying to plan this. Meanwhile,
Mary
Harris,
joke.
AKA Mother Jones, who was really talking like a lot of good shit before this, was like, don't do it. You'll all die or go to jail. Like, you know, just being like, not really being down, not being down to ride. And then so everyone was like, fuck Mother Jones. It's a boring magazine.
nice.
And they decided that they were going to go fuck some shit up in Mingo County, which meant they had to go over Blair Mountain, which the Logan County Sheriff's Department had kind of like embedded themselves on.
These minor boys are at it again.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like 13,000 union.
Must be exhausting being the sheriff in this time period.
Dude, I mean, you know, you thought it was a cushy gig. You just get a star and some moonshine, sit on a stool, but then you got these people who don't want to die at their
what
job.
What do I have to do to rock in this chair? I signed up to rock in my chair.
So there are like 13,000 people in the union forces, all said and done. Like, not just miners, like doctors, actors, like just anyone in the community who wanted to hang out. And they were led by a guy named, literally named Bill Blizzard.
Tight.
Which is so fucking rad.
Founder of Activision Blizzard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he made World of Warcraft.
Yeah. It's based on the Battle of Blair Mountain.
Back then, World of Warcraft was just a bunch of old men sitting around with little figurines on a table. It's like, it's a raid! Leroy Jenkins!
Leroy, goddammit!
drunk on moonshine and shit.
Yeah. So they're all trying to get to Mingo, and they're like leaving at different times. And so, to catch up to the main forces, some of them hijacked a train and renamed it the Blue Steel Special, which I just think is a beautiful
Hell
little color.
Yeah.
You know, just imagine a bunch of fucking like toothless miners just like stealing a train and then riding really fast on a train to go. I don't know. Go fight the government.
I assume you had to like pump it with one of those like. Cartwheel type thing.
Oh, yeah. What's it called? I think it's called a pump cart or something. A push cart or something like that. I don't know.
Pump cart. Little pump cart.
Little pump cart.
As a rapper back in the day, little pump cart. He'd do the ham bone and fucking blow wind over a jug and shit.
Blue Steel Special, though. That's
Rest
not
in
a
peace.
Name. A real name is Mingo. Mingo County.
So the sheriff of Sheriff Chaffin of Logan County is backed by the coal operators, obviously. And so they created what was basically like it's not like a super PAC, but just like a fund called the Coal Operators Association, or the Logan County Coal Operators Association. And so they hired a private army of 2,000 men. And so it's like, imagine like 13,000 of us, and we have like hunting rifles and shit. And then it's like they have 2,000 people from Blackwater. You know, like, that's basically what it is.
Cool. Seems like
no contest.
Fight.
Yeah. No contest. We win.
Yeah, right? So they're also, they have the high ground. They're like, they have like machine gun emplacements. They have mortars.
Didn't they have machine guns mounted on the tops of trains?
Yeah, they did.
That's so fucking funny to me. I don't know. It just sounds cool.
That was like the one infrastructure in the area. So if you controlled the train tracks, like, you controlled pretty much everything.
I just like the idea of like rolling into a scene sideways with a machine gun turret. It's like, ah, ha, 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 ha. You know, you roll right back
I'm
out.
I'm trying to
right.
sleep in this boxcar. I'm shooting.
I was just trying to get to Oklahoma.
I feel like it's almost not a correct comparison to say they're from Blackwater, though, because, you know, like, the trained mercs in 1920s were still just like, whoever could do a karate chop. Whereas these people could fucking kill you with, like, their calf muscle or whatever.
This is just a hobo with, like, a rusty tin can.
Phil's been with me in 3 campaigns, ain't you, Phil? Oh, I miss my wife.
All right, so not Blackwater, but, like, you know, they have Tommy guns and shit.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Off-brand Blackwater.
Graywater.
Yeah.
Graywater, there you go.
You know? So They're skirmishing. Not all the miners get there at once. So, like, the first group of miners, there's a small skirmish. Warren Harding is like, I'm going to send bombers and the National Guard if you guys don't stop this shit. So the miners kind of meet up, and they're like, all right, it's the president. You know, we like the president, I guess. And so
goddamn, do we respect the office.
You know, they really respect the office, and they turn around. And then Chafin is just sitting on
he
Blair
is
Mountain.
Qualified.
Yeah. he's just sitting on Blair Mountain with 2,000 men, and he's like, I wanted a battle. And so he just goes down to Sharples. That's a town name, Sharples.
Sure.
Sure. That's not real.
You all know Sharples. Goes down to
Do you
Sharples.
Mean Staples?
He goes to Staples, who was a big union-supporting organization. They were giving him all the office supplies they needed, paperweights, tech assistants, and just anyone in a red shirt, he just started killing. He started just shooting people who were, like, known union sympathizers.
Oh, my God.
And, like, women and children were killed in the crossfire, and, like, so after that, the miners, like, turned back around, and we had the Battle of Blair Mountain, which had lasted for about a week, just fighting up and down the mountain. And all said and done, I think, like, 50 of, you know, the private army were killed, and then, like, 100 to 150 miners were killed. And then what's the exact number? I have it written down. And then 985 miners were arrested for murder, conspiracy to commit murder, and treason.
Oh, I fucking hate this.
Because you know how it's treasonous to, you
good
know,
sir.
To be like, hey, stop killing me.
I would like a raise.
Yeah.
Treasoner! It's an act of war. Remember this week when everyone was yelling at Trump, like, it's an act of war that he colluded with Putin or whatever?
I don't know.
He's like, I don't even know what's happening.
The word treason is just so funny because it's just an abstract nationalistic fucking thing to get mad about.
Yeah, Trump disrespecting America is the only thing I like about him.
Yeah.
It's basically like a nation just being like, you hurt my feelings. Yeah. I trusted you.
You have to be really into the idea of a state to be like, treason, sir. Yeah. Like, the only person who should be mad about treason is, like, the king of a fucking thing.
I feel like you have to have, like, a lot of jowls to say the word treason. You have to be like,
treason! I object. Yeah.
So another fun fact, though, about the private army is they hired private planes to drop homemade bombs made with leftover gas from World War One.
Big bowling ball cartoon bombs, right?
Yeah, basically. Yeah.
Sweet.
And, like, the only reason, like, a lot of miners got off is because they found, like, bombs that, like, didn't go off, and they were like, they were dropping these on us. Please?
Oh, wow.
You know, like,
full of all the stuff you're not allowed to poison people with.
You remember the Geneva Convention?
Now.
So that's the Battle of Blair Mountain. It's the largest armed labor uprising in U.S. history.
Cool.
And, you know, I'd love to say that, like, after that, the governor was like, we got to protect these miners. Or the president was like, we got to get safe working conditions. Nothing really happened. Union membership didn't really go up again until the New Deal. It's really as cool as it is and, like, as, like, rad it is as it is. And, it, like, we should, like, learn from it so we don't have to fucking shoot our way out of labor disputes
again. We should break that record by Amazon employees staging an armed fucking uprising and then throwing, like, DVDs, box sets at people and shit and, bumping drones into people and shit.
Yeah.
Just throwing weird random crap you can buy all over the place.
Yeah, killing someone with the complete box set of Stargate.
Yeah.
You know?
Dropping bath bombs on people.
It's going to happen from the people who are working in the Venmo towns out west, you know? Mm.
I hear there's some Bitcoin out there still. Held it out California way.
Weird prospector guy.
Yeah. But, yeah, so, I mean, I think the main thing they did wrong was they didn't kill all the rich people. They didn't kill anyone who owned a mine or, like, threaten the family of anyone who owned a mine. They were only fighting, like, you know, police officers and, like, you know, like, the National Guard, really.
Right.
You know, like, they, like, it was a problem with capital, but they fought, you know, like, local, state, and federal government instead of, you know, the people who controlled the capital.
Right, because the people who controlled it just hired a bunch of people to fight.
Exactly.
And be their pawns instead of just kill a bunch of them. And it doesn't matter to them.
Exactly.
Because the power structure is still in place, so it'll just...
It's almost like they should have seized the means of production from the people who owned the factory.
But that's nonsense.
Yeah. All right, bro.
Alex, I hate to tell you, this is America. And we don't believe that here.
All right.
You should have seized the memes of production.
Just,
you know what I'm
riffing on a podcast.
You should have seized the Mingos of production. I don't know. I got nothing.
Yeah. See, you want to say something because it's a ridiculous name. But what is there to say?
It is fun.
Yeah.
A Mingo ate my baby.
There you go.
And then... I mean, after that, you just have, like, 80 years of history of how West Virginia is just completely, like, used for their mineral resources and then, like, left to, like, either die in the process of getting them or die of cancer caused by, like, you know, side effects of that. Like, we have these things in West Virginia called coal slurry impoundments. They're also, like, you know, they're all over Appalachia, which are basically, like, if you... remove the top of a mountain by, like, blowing it up, and then you strip mine it, you have, like, a big empty crater in the top of it, so they'll just dam up coal slurry, which is a byproduct of, like, when you wash coal so that you can, like, use it in a power plant.
This is like at Long John Silver's, so you can just buy crispy stuff, which is just the batter that falls off of the other shit that they cook.
Exactly.
For, like, you know, cheaper.
So it's a dam of batter,
mm-hmm.
Which is, like... you know, super, super toxic.
When they take the mountain batter out, it's very deadly to the workers.
Yeah. And,
oh, it's, you know, sweet, so kill you.
So there are these dams that house, like, you know, just so much of this stuff. And they're, you know, if they're at the top of a mountain, that means they're above a valley, which is where people live. So, like, all of these things are just, like, these people just live in valleys with, like, you know, hundreds of thousands of gallons of toxic waste above them, you know?
Yeah. You're from, like, a black and white cartoon land.
It kind of is,
just,
you know?
Evil,
like,
goop fucking water falling down a mountain.
Yeah, like, one time my gym teacher didn't want to give me an A, and he tied my mom to some train tracks. It was nuts, dude.
he was a cow.
Yeah.
With big white gloves.
And I was like, hey, dude, that's kind of reminiscent of a minstrel show. I don't know if that's really... And he was like, shut up.
And then everyone danced.
He just said, shut up. That's what he said.
He said it, but it was in it's a silent cartoon. So like a card just came on. It's like, shut up! Exclamation point. Him waving his finger at you.
I shot a gun at him and it said bang, you know?
Anyway, so it's good we've completely gutted the EPA.
Mm-hmm.
And this situation will only improve from here.
I'm going to pause real quick.
So, yeah, so like, you know, like coal impoundments are... they're, like, a big fucking problem, you know, like, because, like, you know, obviously mining regulations and anything to do with that industry is like, it's all a fucking sham. You know, like none of the inspectors can really either do anything or stop anything. So they're always like either leaking or, you know, like it's bad news, you know? So
it's a real rigmarole,
you know, you have Buffalo Creek in 1972, which is when a coal impoundment by the, owned by the Pitson Company, burst. And so, you know, it's just a dam at the top of a mountain, which I think it held something like 100. It was 132 million gallons of coal slurry. Which spilled out into the valley below, destroying 17 towns.
Is that why they stopped selling coal slurry at Dairy Queen?
No, they still use it in the blizzards. That's what keeps it from falling out.
Cool. It's in cookies and cream.
Mr. Blizzard.
It killed 125 people, injured 1,121. And
imagine like, you're just sitting on your porch just whittling.
Yeah.
And then just like a you literally, fucking...
That's a lot of slurry.
Well, it's not stopping.
Oh. Wow,
I better whittle faster.
Well, I better go tell Karen.
Yeah, like 4,000 people are homeless. The governor at the time, like, started a commission to investigate it. Like, when the UMWA was like, hey, maybe put a miner on that commission because they kind of know about that stuff. He was like, ha, no. And at the end of it, he found that the findings were, like, way too damning. So he suppressed his own commission's report. All in all, he made Pitson pay $1 million in damages when, like, the cost of rebuilding and, like, outside of what, like, civil, like, dues were probably, like, needed to be paid. It was all in, like, the hundreds of millions.
Are
you
there
know?
Any of,
like,
these labor battles where it ends and you think, oh, good, everything was fine?
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. I haven't seen the outline.
So
these are a bunch of, yeah, things to learn from, I guess, in terms of labor uprisings.
And it's like a thing
failed experiments
to hear about in general, because like in my history book, in like my West Virginia history class, they just say the flood of 1972 in Buffalo Creek. They just call it a flood.
Yeah.
Talk about like the damage. Like they mention nothing.
You got to go out of your way to learn about all this.
Yeah.
Shit. Because yeah, I mean, Texas is the same way. Where like the. For some reason, you have to take 9 years of Texas history in Texas,
wow,
but it's
really?
Just
what?
Like some absurd number like that. Like every other year in school, you have to take it, but then it's also completely whitewashed history. So you're just the reason no one from Texas has any historical context for anything is because that's history class,
right?
Is just learning like
how it's Rascal Flatts lyrics.
Yeah, it's just like Sam Houston and his giant blue ox ended slavery, and it's just a bunch of shit that's not true.
And now we'll watch the Three Amigos again.
So
Ozzy Osbourne pissed on the Alamo.
That is true, though.
And so, like, the largest dam in the world is actually a coal slurry impoundment. It's up top a Brushy Fork down near Beckley, West Virginia. It holds 31 million cubic meters of coal slurry, and it's been expanded three times. And, like, every time that they expand it, they don't dig down to bedrock to, like, put in new walls. They just put it on top of, like fallen coal sediment. So it's literally they're building something twice the size of the Hoover Dam on top of, like, what is, like, coal sand mixed with water. Like, so it's going to break eventually.
Yeah.
And if it broke, it would reach from, like, the center of West Virginia, probably floodwaters would reach, like, Kentucky. Like, it's no good.
Holy shit.
It's not good at all. And this is all able to happen because West Virginia's government is just the wackiest shit in the whole fucking world.
It's like a hard right state for local politics, right?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, because Joe Manchin's out there.
Joe Manchin is our senior senator.
And he's a... Is he a Democrat?
He's a Democrat.
But he like acts like a Republican.
Yeah,
right?
He shot the cap and trade bill in a commercial.
He shot the captain.
He's like the Cuomo of West Virginia.
Okay, yeah.
Pace yourself.
It just bothers me his name isn't Joe Manchin. It's so close,
yeah.
And it would be so appropriate, and it's just not there.
I mean,
how about Manchin? He's got a huge chin, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Look at my man's chin. It's out of control.
How about a Manchin for the fellas? So that was a cumtown joke.
You know, we'd all love to get a better representative than him in the Senate, but the only person that keeps running against him is fucking Don Blankenship.
That fucker.
Who was responsible for the Upper Big Branch mine explosion, which killed 29 people.
Right. Yeah.
and has the personality of, like, a literal sheet of rock. Like, he sucks so bad, dude. Like,
is there, like, a shooting test to run? Why are you just getting, like, Yosemite Sam's?
He's paying him to run because it's, like, he's basically MacGruber, yeah, so he can't win, you know?
I mean, he was the guy that, like, was on the news, like, a couple months ago just because he was running for primary. He's like, I'm going to stand up against Cocaine Mitch and his China family. You guys remember him?
Yeah, I remember that.
That's old Don Blankenship.
He kept saying China family and Cocaine Mitch.
He's like, I don't know if it's, like, a form of autism or something, but he just, like, has, like, these fucking slogans that make no sense. He'll be like, I'm going to bring coal back for the sake of the kids. Vote Don Blankenship. And it fucking makes no sense. I don't know. And our other senator is the daughter of the governor who only made the Pitts and Company pay $1 million to West Virginia. It's all fucked. It's all... I could go on for so long, but it's all fucked.
In conclusion, West Virginia.
A land of contrasts.
In conclusion, all politicians are bought. The real tyrannical government is a corporate oligarchy. Use your Second Amendment rights and...
Yeah.
I don't know. Shoot up the Amazon headquarters or something. Allegedly, don't do that or whatever. But do it.
Satire.
Satire.
That's my new catchphrase after I say
I like that.
Everything.
That's very useful.
Something about the cadence really gets me.
All right. Cool.
Thanks
well,
for coming on, man.
Yeah.
Thanks for having me. I know I just kind of fucking...
No, it's quite interesting little purview into... I don't know, West Virginia. I think the reason I thought that was kind of interesting is because to a lot of people, especially like liberals, you know, that part of the country is this mythologized thing. Mm-hmm. That a lot of people don't understand the history of like labor uprisings and stuff there. I mean, to a lot mm-hmm. of people, I think it's just a one note, like, oh, you know, bunch of hicks and a trailer idiots voted for Trump. I've talked about that a million times on the show. I don't think that's the case. It's, you know, Trump is elected by the middle
class.
They're
militant mountain people, and you need them to win the revolution.
Yeah, we are swing states.
Are you happy?
West Virginia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
People misunderstand poor populations all over the country because they're not very well represented, and the history of them isn't well represented, you know?
Mm-hmm.
History's written by the winners, et cetera.
The sinners.
Hell yeah, dude. Marilyn Manson. Yeah. I'm going to go suck my own dick.
Let's go out to Marilyn Manson sucking his own dick.
I've already like thought of...
Put it in the mashup.
Yeah. Marilyn Manson, Little Peep, Idea. Probably some cool folk music, too. It's going to be sick, dude.
Maybe Mbop and do Marilyn Hanson, huh? How about that?
Wow.
Those fucking Hanson kids sucking their own dicks.
They're adults. It's fine.
Yeah, they're adults now. They can suck their own dicks.
They can make their own decisions.
Cool. That's a fucking fascinating story. And obviously, you know, one that's kind of important and cool being the largest armed labor uprising in American history until... You know?
Until 2020, huh?
Soon, baby. Let's do it. anyway, thanks for joining us. Is there anything you want to plug?
Not really. I mean, I run a monthly show in Brooklyn at Fulton Ale House every second Saturday of the month at 8 p.m. It's always good comics. Me and Ethan SP host it. It's a great show. Come by. And then you can follow everything else I'm doing. I'm on Twitter at @max_Ogle and on that on all the platforms. So, yeah, I guess that's it.
Just follow Max around.
Follow me around.
Yeah. Follow him around.
Follow me around. Hey.
Follow Max around in one of those train cart things that you have to pump up and down.
Yeah.
Pump cart.
Pump cart. Oh yeah, we talked about that.
Pump cart.
Those video game Donkey Kong carts.
Yeah, we'll go off screen right, and then I'll come back off screen right, going screen left, and you can be behind me. It'll be a nice cartoon. It'll be fun.
We'll be on the cart. A large bear will be behind us, and we'll be moving towards the screen.
And then how about we just run in and out of different doors with no real sense made?
It's like following Max.
Yeah. Yeah.
Scooby-Doo.
Yeah, it's like a Scooby cartoon. Anybody else?
Follow me, ACLU Official. Follow me on Facebook, where you can watch me fight with people. I don't do much fighting. Jake does all the fighting now. But anyway, ACLU Official. Follow me on Facebook. I got a weekly show, Airplane Mode, Cherry Tree Bar, every Thursday, 8 p.m.
Hi, follow me on Twitter at Patak Jokes. Come to my weekly show every Sunday at 7 at Sing Sing on Avenue A. Bad news, it's a comedy show. We dress up and do the news, and it's a comedy show. And listen to my other podcast, Ballin' Out Super.
You know who I am. Follow me on my bullshit. Rate, review, subscribe. Yeah, I don't know. I'll be out back on the road soon. Sign up for the Patreon, bonus apps, and all that shit. That's it.
And now, check out this jam.
Yeah, check out this fucking mashup. Pew, 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 wee, 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 wee. Those aren't DJ noises. I don't know what I was doing. Pew, 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 pew. What the fuck is that?
The tide is coming, I've been running, trying to function fine without my mind climbing out this fucking corner. I was born a thorn away from the rock, the metal, the forgotten rebel, craft in the absence of heaven.
You like attention, younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze.
Here is something you can't understand.
I work at this killer man.
Here is country roads, take me home to the place I belong.
Where's the lots of pretty ones? You wanna kiss you?
Dead, who was a philosopher that I thought that I learned a lot from, and that was a title that I was given, so a lot of people made a lot out of it.
Yeah, but I mean, look, if you're a reverend,
it's not a real job.
Satan.
I didn't get paid for it.
But why, if you want to get those kids, those lonely right. kids, and you want them to be able to be creative mm-hmm. and burst out of that, why the bizarre presentation, which can be misinterpreted?
I think everybody's got a presentation. Everybody looks a certain way because they want to convey a certain image. You look a certain way because you want people to listen to you in a certain way.
Are you an exhibitionist?
I'm kind of shy, and I think that I take that out by performing in front of a lot of people. That's how I get out my shyness. So.